late afternoon here in California, Bay Area. Very beautiful day. And here we are with another satsang, which means sitting and listening to clarification about truth. It's very important that satsang be more than just a 5-minute clip on YouTube. Very important. 5-minute clip on YouTube is like playing like one hole in golf. Maybe you get lucky and you hit a couple good shots on the hole and you think, oh, I can play golf. Not a problem. What you need to do is go out and play 18 holes on a tough course and that then find out how good your game is. What'll happen is you will begin to see the whole picture of your game when you play 18 holes. Same thing with satsang. You need to have an extended period of time where you're focusing in and becoming aware of the ebb and flow of your clarity and whether you can stick with it and go deeper into deeper clarity, and you could be able to see your defenses come up, your lack of attention, the tricks your mind is playing to distract you. All of those things are extremely important, which you don't get in a 5-minute clip. What's more is that we are headed into a time now of great activity in the world. I would call it great agitation. It's right. The storm is brewing, and it's the outer edge of the storm are now being felt by those who are sensitive to it. This is something that has been foreseen. It's a cosmic thing. It's a planetary thing. It's a cultural thing. All that filters down to individuals feeling it. And it's an existence thing, meaning it's an ego thing. Existence is the play of the ego. It's a play of forgetfulness. It's a play of forgetfulness of what we are. Some say it's a game we're playing with ourselves. Well, it's more than a game. It's not really a game. We try to make it into a game, like we're singing. Well, we wouldn't need to forget what we are. So let's make it fun. Let's turn it into a game. Make it seem like, hey kids, we're just playing a game here. There's a very serious purpose to it. And there's extreme misery and suffering inherent within this attempt to forget what we are. So it's not good to see it as a game. I know that traditionally some have talked about it as if a game. I would say do not use that type of terminology. Terminology is helpful. It's not all important. It's used for the purpose of clarification. It's a means and not an end in itself. So never get stuck on arguing over terminology. If have faith in those who have clarity, and when they use certain terminology, just have faith that yes, this is for the sake of helping make some key distinctions, seeing some things. So I say that don't see it as a game. See it as a tremendous effort to forget what we are. Very serious effort. Because that's what it really is. And we try to make it fun, sugarcoat it by saying it's a game. It's not a game. There's no winners. Only losers. In being forgetful of what we are, we only have losers. No winners in that game. So it's not really a game at all. By making it seem like a game, we think there's winners and losers, and we like to identify who the winners are and who the losers are. The only winners are not in this game of existence, but those who choose a different idea. Instead of forgetting what they are, they choose the idea of remembering what they are. That's a different situation. So they're not winners in the game of forgetting what you are, what we are. No, they're remembering what they are. And in that, there are only winners. And if they're only winners, then the term winners is not really relevant. Because the term winners also implies the term losers. There are simply those who choose to experience, to abide in the experience and feeling of deep remembrance of what they are. And there are those who choose to abide in the feeling of deep forgetfulness of what they are. Those are the two choices that we have, the only two choices we have. There are no other choices. There's no choice of... It's like truth and lies. Is there some other third option? Truthful lies or lying truth? It's not an option. There's no such option. So the key to awakening is to realize there's only two options, not three. Not a multiplicity of options. Only two. Once you see that, the whole situation becomes very simple and clear. The whole point of the ego is to deceive us into believing that there are some other options. And that somehow, in order to be fair to ourselves, we need to entertain this third option. But there isn't any third option. When the ego tells you there is, it's actually telling you to stick with lies. Stick with deep forgetfulness of what we are. That's all that it's really asking you, but it's disguised, it's sugar-coated. So we're entering a time of great agitation. And in this time, one can either choose to experience that great agitation, which will deepen the forgetfulness or keep it extremely deep, or one can choose to pay attention to satsang, which is an orientation towards choosing deep remembrance. It's not the deep remembrance itself. It's not an end in itself. It's a means. It's a reminder. But a very important reminder. So one can then choose satsang. So it's either choose agitation, deep agitation, extreme agitation, or choose satsang. That's the only two choices people have right now. There is no third choice. The world is inherently a place of deep forgetfulness. So if we're not experiencing satsang, we are experiencing deep forgetfulness and the means to remain in deep forgetfulness. Guaranteed. And there certainly are those who have paid attention to satsang their entire life. Self-inquiry is another term for satsang. Contemplation is another term. Finding the highest truth and paying attention to that in an extended way, prolonged, determined, day after day sort of situation, whether it be a teacher, whether it be a book, whether it be inner guidance, whether it be practicing a meditation, all of that is satsang, a type of paying attention to truth. Paying attention to clarification of truth, clarification that there's only two options, either truth or lies. That's it. There are no truthful lies. Never has been, never will be. Let's say you make a closed fist with a little bit of space inside and you shut out all the light from that little closed space in your hand there, and now you open your hand quickly. How long did it take for that darkness within your hand to be dissipated? Wasn't it instantaneously? Where did it go? It instantaneously replaced by light, just so that lies, forgetfulness is instantaneously replaced with deep remembrance. The remembrance replaces the forgetfulness. Forgetfulness is not a thing. It's an overlooking the truth. And so when one ceases to overlook the truth, the overlooking is no longer being practiced. And there's no great struggle for truth to replace lies, just like when you open your hand. There's no struggle for the light to replace the darkness that was there previously. Because the darkness wasn't a thing in itself. It was simply a lack of something. And when the lack is supplied, there's no longer a lack there. So lies are not anything in themselves, it's simply a lack of truth. When the truth is supplied, there's no more lack of truth. It's like that. So extended satsang is what we've been working towards on this channel, YouTube channel, going from short videos to slightly longer to stretching out to an hour and a half, sometimes two and a half. It may come a time when there's a necessity for extended live broadcasts, a couple hours or more, should the agitation in the world be such that people really, really realize that they need to make a choice. And again, an extended satsang gives one the opportunity to work on it, because one begins to see the defenses arise, and it gives one time to work on those defenses. Again, just like playing around a golf, which is something that I do because it's very instructive about one's life, where when you play 18 holes, you get a chance to find out what your weaknesses are, what's the problem is, and then work on it, fix it, get better. That just happened to me a couple days ago. Played very poorly for most of the round, and then I suddenly got a tip from another player, and I realized what I was doing wrong, fixed it, and then everything changed, played beautifully. It's the simple things. I was able to, you know, gave me the time to see what was, I recognized something wasn't right, and then found out what it is, and then fix it. If you only play one hole, maybe you hit some bad shots, and you say, I can't play this game. It's terrible. I'm terrible. Forget it. I'm quitting. It's a funny thing. Oftentimes, when the first hole is played poorly, that acts as a wake-up call, and then the rest of the round seems to get better and better and better, and you play a great round. Whereas if you play the first hole really good, oftentimes it goes downhill from there. It's a weird thing. That's why a lot of players say they never want to birdie the first hole. Because usually a bad round follows. I don't know why, but it seems to be true. So sometimes when you stumble out of the gate, it's a shock. And you say, boy, I don't want to play 18 holes like this. I really better figure out and get everything going. And then they end up having a really good round because the focus is there. Same thing with satsang. Maybe you stumble out of the gate and you say, I don't know, I can't follow what's going on. My mind is just not there, and just it doesn't seem to be relevant, and why am I here, and all this stuff. And then you think, oh my gosh, there's going to be 2.5 hours of this, you know. And if you really have to be there for 2.5 hours, you might say, well, I better lock in and focus and get with it. Otherwise, I'm going to be bored out of my mind. It's going to be horrible. It's like that. Whereas if you're locked in at the beginning, perhaps you might say, okay, I got the first 5 minutes of it. That's enough. I've got it. And then you say, oh my gosh, then the rest of the 2 hours, your mind is just kind of wandering all over the place like that. It can happen like that. It's kind of a marathon. You get started, you get rolling, you find your pace, you lock into it, and you keep it going. And then you finish strong. And you battle through the fatigue, the weak spots, the distractions, everything your mind does, and you keep locking back onto the message. That's why the message needs to be repeated periodically, to give everyone an opportunity to get back to it, to lock back onto it. Because it'll keep slipping away. Why? You cannot have both clarity, remembrance, and deep forgetfulness simultaneously. So what happens is one will get close to deep remembrance and feel you're almost there. Then you say, okay, now let me blend this with what I'm used to, which is deep forgetfulness. And then in that blending, the clarity is gone. And then one feels, lost it. Where'd it go? Disappeared. Because the entire idea of getting close to truth is you're getting close to realizing that there's no exception to truth. That only perfect remembrance suffices to remember what we are, because what we are is perfect. There's no such thing as an imperfect remembrance. So as soon as we make an exception to truth, we say, okay, we've got the truth, now let me make a little exception to it here and blend it that, you know, and accommodate that little exception. You lose sight of the clarity altogether, it disappears. And you don't know where it went. Very frustrating. You say, just a minute ago I was very clear, and now I've completely forgotten what happened. Couldn't possibly have wandered that far away from it. But the answer is yes, we have, because we tried to accommodate an exception to truth. And that invalidates truth altogether. The very meaning of truth is that there's no exception to it. When you try to change the meaning of truth, saying that there's an exception to it, you're not talking about truth anymore. You're actually talking about a lie about truth. Truth and lies cannot be integrated. As soon as we turn toward integration, integrating truth and lies, we lose sight of truth altogether. And then we're floundering. So in satsang, you have periods of truth, clarity, and then you will suddenly start floundering. And you've lost it. That's why one gradually learns to keep a steady, open, clear, focused mind and not leap to try and integrate anything that one sees. Simply allow the seeing to be there, arise, and then do not try to add anything or subtract anything. Don't try to blend it with anything. Don't try to imagine scenarios like what you're going to do with it. Just kind of feel the impact of the clarity. Let the impact just be there. And if possible, feel a little feeling of gratitude. Grateful that you're giving yourself the opportunity to clarify where your real freedom from suffering can be found, will be found. So be grateful to yourself, because you're the one who is providing the opportunity for yourself for this to take place. And it's very important to speak in adamant terms. That's the only way. Conciliatory terms, concessional terms, terms of integration, terms of compromise. That's no teaching at all. It's absolutely meaningless. The real teacher that you want to meet up with will tell you that everything other than choosing a new idea is meaningless. It's nothing. The term nothing will be used a lot. Meaningless. No meaning. Therefore it's nothing. It serves no purpose for you. Forgetfulness of what we are is a temporary situation only. Will never be permanent. Because what we are remains what we are, even though we're forgetful of it. So forgetfulness is just temporary. And we struggle for stability by trying to make forgetfulness permanent, thinking that that's where our stability would be found. As if permanent forgetfulness of what we are would be some kind of perfect stability. Theoretically, you could claim that. That can be claimed. Plausibly. But the premise is wrong, in that what we are remains what we are, even in spite of all our forgetfulness. So there's no such thing as a permanent forgetfulness, meaning that that which is forgotten has now ceased to be. There's no such thing that it can ever happen. Therefore, forgetfulness, at its very best, is temporary. It's all that it is. All that can ever be, temporary. So it can never have the kind of stability that the ego claims it can have. The ego's lying when it says that in perfect forgetfulness, stability will be found. Because there's no such thing as perfect forgetfulness. It's a meaningless statement. The only choice one has is between perfect forgetfulness and perfect remembrance. That's it. I'm sorry. The only choice one has is between perfect remembrance of what we are and deep forgetfulness of what we are. Not perfect forgetfulness. I was smelling some smoke. There's some strong smoke in the neighborhood. So I was distracted by that. Because something is burning. I'm not sure what it is. So you see, distraction can happen. And words that are used can be jumbled up a little bit. But there again, just because words get misplaced doesn't mean that which they're referring to gets misplaced. Just because we call, let's say we might call water, so we have some nice glass of water and we get confused and distracted and we call it dirt. Does that mean that we then cannot drink the water? Does it somehow be turned into dirt? No, it does not, obviously. The ego believes in the power of words. That's the only power that it has, is a definitional power. And it thinks that somehow truth is at the mercy of definition, the mercy of words, that which is being referred to is somehow at the mercy of the reference, which is, again, complete nonsense. Totally insane. If we refer to the permanent as impermanent, does that mean that it becomes impermanent? What power does definition really have? It has none. The only right use of definition is to make clear distinctions like this. That which is being referred to is not at the mercy of the reference. If we think something's on fire, that's a strong distraction. So I momentarily got caught up in that just a little bit. Again, there's no such thing as perfect forgetfulness. There's deep forgetfulness, but it can never be perfect because it's impermanent. It cannot last forever, eternally. Cannot be endless. Only what we are is endless. Endlessness is endless. The forgetfulness of endlessness does not transcend endlessness. It does not become more than endlessness. It's always less. Endless because endlessness is more. Defining endpoints for endlessness is never as great as the endlessness itself. Because no matter what endpoint we define, endlessness continues on past that. And these things may seem very simple and basic, but they're at the very root of our troubles. Because the ego employs these tactics on us in very clever ways. What we need to do is point out the general tactics so that one can realize, oh, okay, there's something going on like this. And just back away from the situation. And say, no, there's only one choice I need to make, either deep forgetfulness or deep remembrance. That's it. Literally, that is the only choice we have in existence. There are no other real choices, no other meaningful choices at all. And so, only emphasizing this is important. Everything else is meaningless. The emphasis has to be on we either choose deep forgetfulness or deep remembrance. Every moment, we're either choosing one or the other. If we choose deeper forgetfulness, we're choosing the meaningless, nothing. And if we choose deep remembrance, we're choosing to remember what we are, which is eternal life, endless beingness, free to choose and play and experience all ideas, invulnerable, uncorruptible, undistortable, life, truth, expression, and experiencing, direct experiencing, not at the mercy of anything, not at the mercy of words, belief, concepts, or even the idea that it's at the mercy of this idea. No. So satsang has to deliver this strong type of message. Otherwise, it's delivering a compromise, message of compromise, which does not protect from agitation. What it does is it builds one up to believe that one can somehow mediate agitation. It gets one to believe that there is a third compromise position that is possible, and therefore one believes that one can become a mediator and talk to both sides of a conflict and bring about a compromise that neither side saw that is acceptable to both sides. This is delusion. This is arrogance. This is conceit. This is a false path. This is what leads one into great suffering. There is no compromise between truth and lies. There is no position that will satisfy both truths and lies. No such thing. And the belief that there is leads one into extreme suffering and misery, because one tries to act quicker and quicker and quicker and accommodate all sorts of different conflicting positions, zigzag, oscillate, and one becomes very confused and messed up and depressed and chaotic, and one's life comes, like it feels like it's torn apart by storms. So satsang gets one out of that situation by saying there's no possible compromise between truth and lies. You have to choose one or the other. Therefore, there is no hero that brings conflicting parties together. There's no conflict between truth and lies. Truth is true and lies are not true. Where is there a conflict? No conflict. The only conflict is between lies, one lie and another lie. Different styles of asserting compromise. That's where the conflict is. One can choose clarity, truth, and then choose lies and go back and forth and then claim there's some conflict there, but it's not true. There's no conflict. Truth doesn't feel any conflict from lies. Where's the conflict? Truth knows truth is true. Doesn't pay any attention to lies. It knows that lies are not true. So it's not conflicted about it. Conflict comes when one says, well, these are both true, and which one do we choose, and how do we accommodate both? So the ego is locked into this belief that both truth and lies are true, and it's struggling to accommodate both, and of course that's a chaotic, terrible situation, because it has to misrepresent truth to believe that truth and lies can be both accommodated together. And then an uncertainty and instabilities are there, and those have to be dealt with, and one builds a house of cards, and then one becomes very miserable maintaining that house of cards and the stability to keep it from collapsing. It's a nightmare. So satsang is to help one get out of that nightmare. Because most who enter satsang have been there and done that, have built that house of cards up, tried to be a hero of the dream, and experienced the enormous suffering of trying to keep that house of cards stable. Because lies are always moving, having to retain deep forgetfulness, and always pushing that. So any accommodation it's trying to make with truth, that is constantly being buffeted and shifted and moved around, so it too will be forgotten entirely. Redefined, played with in all sorts of ways. And one gets very confused. Don't want that. We want to come out of that confusion to clarity. And the way to do that is to see, simply see, there's only one choice we need to make. There's only one choice in all of existence, really, whether we continue with deep forgetfulness or choose deep remembrance of what we are. That's the only choice there is. Only one choice. So there's only one way, in other words, to make that choice. Choose again. This time decide to choose deep remembrance of what we are. That's the one choice. And then having made that choice, the effect of that idea will manifest, which is what I call the overlay, vision of Christ, vision of oneness, peace beyond understanding, nirvana. That will manifest automatically. And then one simply abides in that. Abidance in the self. It's called, has been called that too. And then there's no lack of stability. It's perfect stability. So one doesn't have to go looking to get rid of instability. So there's nothing else that one needs to do. Nothing that needs else needs to be accomplished. The whole notion of accomplishment is finished. Then one simply turns to abidance in the experiencing of this overlay. This stability is one effect that covers all other effects. So in any situation that one is in, the question to ask is, am I practicing deep, am I oriented towards deep remembrance of what I am or deep forgetfulness of what I am? Is this satsang? If you're in a situation, ask, is this satsang? Is this clear reminders of the one choice I have to make? Is that being presented to me with adamant clarity and re-emphasized over and over? And if it's not, you can be sure it's then emphasizing deep forgetfulness. Can't be doing both. Remember, oscillation is deep forgetfulness. It's the idea that somehow there's some something other than the self. And that is deep forgetfulness, right? The whole idea that there's some other option, other self, some new self, and that these are the effects of the new self, this oscillation. That is deep forgetfulness of what we are, because what we are is permanent, is eternal, cannot be replaced. It's an idea in the mind of God. Ideas don't leave their source when they're extended. So the idea that there's some other self is deep forgetfulness of what we are. And this oscillation, thinking that this effect is coming from some other self, is a lie. It's simply our own choosing to oscillate and then just plausibly assert that this coming from another self. We just can't see this self. It's a mystery. There's some kind of mystery self that's giving rise to this oscillation. Not true. Some people have said that's the I, that there's some I there that's giving rise to the personality, the oscillation, the uncertainty going back and forth. You know, is it this, that, maybe it's this, maybe it's that. A little bit of clarity, okay, now confusion, and I can try to accommodate both truth and lies, and all of this personality we have, we say that's coming from some self or something. It's not. It's simply arising from the effort to forget what we are. That's why some say there is no I. In other words, there's no self giving rise to our personality. to this play, these dynamics of forgetfulness that we're employing, that are being employed by spirit, using mind. Mind is presenting all this, but mind is the servant of spirit, so mind is presenting this play of confusion and delusion. There's no I, there's no self that's giving rise to this. We're told that there is. We're all assuming this is so. We have to, otherwise we'd realize, wait a minute, it's not coming from any other than it must be coming from our own desire to forget what we are. It becomes very obvious. But by saying there's some other third party, another self, that's giving rise to this, and we're just experiencing the effects of this other self, that's a lie. It's not true. There's no other self. This is arising from an idea that spirit is choosing, not from some other self. This is essentially what self-inquiry, who am I? That's what they're getting at. Find this I that is giving rise to this, and there is none. But we can draw a more panoramic picture than that. I like to talk about the actual root of this confusion that's arising. Look at it from an even earlier point than who am I? That question. A more fundamental point that we either will be experiencing deep forgetfulness of what we are, or deep remembrance of what we are. And this whole notion about I is simply experiencing deeper forgetfulness of what we are. That's its purpose. So focus on the level of purpose, the level of idea. What's the purpose of existence? To provide deep forgetfulness of what we are. And the whole notion that there's some I giving rise to this deep forgetfulness, that is just a tactic that is being used. It's not the only tactic. It's something that most of us can relate to, but not necessarily. I never related to that, like, who am I? I never related to that. I understand what they're getting at, but I never related to that. I related to, I think, something more fundamental, which is spirit chose the idea of trying to be prime creator. And in order to try and experience this idea, it has to forget what it is, has to go into deep forgetfulness of what it is, has to. So that's what gave rise to this whole charade of existence, and this notion there's some I giving rise to our oscillations and conflict, and the whole everything that arises as a persona, and the dynamics that arise that we call a persona, this play of Maya, play of delusion, thinking that it's coming from some other self that distracts us, misleads us away from looking to where it's really coming from. I always knew where it came from, so I never even thought about I at all. I said, no, it's coming from spirit. Spirit chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. And this automatically gives rise to a whole scenario play of forgetfulness, automatically, inescapably. So it's important to look at causation. So technically, I don't emphasize who am I type of inquiry. I emphasize self-inquiry, meaning inquire into the deepest causation of the whole situation of existence. Why did it arise in the first place? Why is it here? Why are we suffering this? Why are we even talking about this problem we have? Where did it all come from? That is more fundamental. And if we look at it this way, then the whole question of who am I easily gets resolved. Just see it. So obviously that's just a tactic. That ego, a tactic of misdirection that ego is using, that mind is using. That keeps us looking for this other self. Thinking that somehow we can find this other self and then reason with it and help straighten it out. There is no such other self to find. So it's a waste of time. Try to straighten something out that doesn't exist. What we need to do is we need to choose a new idea. choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. Automatically that gives rise to the one effect of non-negation, of that which is not trying to forget what it is. It's simply an overlay. It's a feeling that overlays all other effects, that isn't disturbed by any other effect. It's one effect that is undisturbed by any other effect. This is what has been called in ancient terms a nirvana, not moving. That which is totally unmoved, undisturbed by any other motion. Some refer to it as the great space, in which everything moves, but it itself doesn't move at all, is untouched by any movement, the unmoving. And that comes by choosing another idea. Exchanging ideas. Exchange the idea of trying to be prime creator to the idea of not trying to be prime creator. And then, if one wants to experience not trying, then one has to have all the elements of trying there, but they're not being employed. So this then brings about what's called the overlay. In other words, all the effects that we employed to forget what we are still there, and yet they're not being used anymore to forget what we are. And in not using any of these effects, the remembrance of what we are is automatically there. We say, I remember. I'm flawless. I'm perfect. I can never be truly forgotten. I'm undisturbed by any attempts to forget what I am. So in other words, all these effects are still there, and yet they do not affect this one effect at all. And that reminds us of what we are. The overlay has such a strong correlation. It's like a perfect symbol of what we really are. And so it brings about this deep remembrance. The overlay is not ourself, but it is a deep remembrance of what we really are. What we really are is direct experiencing, without any concept or thinking at all. Nothing. No symbology at all. We don't need remembrance of what we are, as we're directly experiencing as we are. Now, it's not like we're directly experiencing what we are and then saying, I'm remembering what I am. No. So remembrance of what we are comes first. It's a remedy. It cancels out. It gently removes the deep forgetfulness, so that then we can finally directly function as we are, which is beyond the scope of any teaching, of any satsang at all. That's something that will take place automatically once the deep remembrance has settled in to perfection. So what we need to do is we need to begin to abide in that deep remembrance, which means awareness of the presence of the overlay. Great teachers have come into the world and they simply are in this condition of the presence of this overlay and showing to us how stable it is. How unflappable this overlay is, how undisturbed it is. You look at these great teachers and you realize there's a presence that's undisturbed. An undisturbed presence. Now, physically, they're in the hustle and bustle of everything, and et cetera, inconveniences seem to arise, the body's inconvenience, this way or that way. But the presence of the undisturbed presence of the overlay remains. That is still there. So one needs to tune into that, and not, that there's a fly buzzing about the teacher or something, and they swat it away, or it's hot and they're sweating, or whatever, there's a transportation and car gets a flat tire, or whatever, That's not the point. The point is that the overlay remains undisturbed, no matter what happens, whether it's rain or shine. And so the reminder is the reminder to choose this overlay. Not to choose the body, the persona of the teacher, but the overlay that is shining, that is there, that is present. It's more than shining, it's actually present. That's what one sees. and the great teachers who will bring this model, this overlay, show it to us. No matter what's happening in the external with the teacher, one is aware that there's this unchanging, perfectly stable, undisturbed presence that is so peaceful there, and it's always there. And then one says, how is that possible? And then one begins to think about that and say, how is this possible? Because everyone else is changing there. They don't have that presence. Wow, where is this coming from? How can they manage to keep this undisturbed presence? Even when they're tired, sleeping, it's still there. Never falters or goes away. What's going on? And then that provides the motivation for deep inquiry. Where is it coming from? And gradually one sees it's coming from a different idea. Not the idea that gave rise to existence. The idea that gave rise to existence, eventually you trace it back. You see, it was the idea of spirit wanting to be prime creator. Then therefore needing to be forgetful of what it is. Because what it is the prime created. That's what it is. So spirit cannot possibly know what it is and believe at the same time that it can be prime creator. That's not possible. Impossible. Spirit either knows what one is, or it just falls into deep forgetfulness of what one is, what it is. And the only reason spirit would fall into deep forgetfulness of what it is the desire, the idea of wanting to be prime creator. It's the only cause of this deep forgetfulness. Only that one silly idea. Only that brings about this deep forgetfulness. All other ideas, spirit can accommodate and acknowledge that what it is, that it's the prime created, an extension of the mind of God. Doesn't have to try and forget what it is. So there's no reason to be in any state of deep forgetfulness of what it is. So the spirit can then just function as it is, directly experiencing, instead of positing that there's something other doing the experiencing. Not it. It's forgotten what it is, so to speak. So this is all very simple, basic, direct, clear, and one can see that it is so. And then where does it go? As again, basic premise of forgetting what one is the idea that there can be exceptions to truth, that one can be both one's what one is and something else, which is really a belief of accommodation. It's really that in we're trying to forget what we are, we've discovered that we have trouble at this, and we keep remembering what we are. Therefore we decide, well, we need to make certain accommodations for this temporarily. We need to accommodate this temporarily. So when one reaches clarity, we'll simply say, oh, okay, well, we can accommodate that within forgetfulness, not a problem. We have a way to accommodate that. And then we'll say, oh, okay, and we'll accept some sort of plausible accommodation for it. And as soon as one does that, clarity disappears. Because there's no accommodation for it. There's no accommodation for truth and lies. None. Zero. Because truth is that there's no exception to truth. Accommodation means that there is an exception to truth. There's truth and also an exception to it. And that within the exception, it's possible to accommodate the truth. That is not true, it's a lie. So what one really chooses is a lie. So one goes back into lying, self-deception. Believing that one is experiencing both truth and lies. And as such is closer to a new self. Because the new self is supposed to be that which can accommodate both truth and lies. There is no such self. There's lots of deities that claim that they can do both. And they get a sense of stability from us worshiping them and believing in them. But this is, again, a complete lie. Meaningless. As we've seen, there's no such thing as some other self that accommodates both truth and lies. This in itself is simply a lie. And lies are simply forgetfulness of what we are, and forgetfulness of what we are can never be stable. It's only temporary. So all these deities are only temporary, and so they can never be satisfied. No matter how much worship one gives them, they're never satisfied because they feel this sense of impermanence in their position. And so they say, well, they need more worship, more sacrifice to get rid of this sense of impermanence. Because the position of forgetfulness of what one is impermanent. It will give way to a deep remembrance of what one is, and will be replaced by that, and therefore it will vanish. And seeing that it's really nothing, it was never anything at all. And these deities, these psychic deities, these in existence, they have this insecurity that they'll be forgotten, which is true. So don't feed those psychic deities. Just put your attention on satsang, which bypasses all of that. Forget about all these levels and dimensions and psychic this. It's all a complete waste of time. They'll simply get lost in confusion. Go right to the root of the whole situation. And see the stark simplicity of it. No such thing as accommodating truth within lies. No such thing. Any belief there is in one is being deceived. Self-deception. Any belief that there is some another self, a new self that can do this, that can accommodate both, is a total lie, total self-deception. Deep forgetfulness of what one is, deep forgetfulness of reality. That's how we keep the deep forgetfulness going, by believing that there is some new self, that there's going to be some evolving of a new self. This whole notion of evolving, of raising consciousness, etc., etc., that's all actually pointing towards a new self that can, supposedly, we believe, can integrate, accommodate both truth and lies. That is nothing but delay. That's the very fabric of delay. That's the very thing that is generating, that is keeping us trapped in delay. That's the very stuff that's bringing it about. So that's the stuff that needs to be pointed out. What we are has always been exactly what it is, and will always be exactly what it is. It's always already the case, and what we are not will never be the case. And there never will be some new self to replace what we are. Because what we are is truth itself. And truth itself, what can replace truth? Can lies replace truth? Is there some truth that isn't true? That isn't already true? No, truth is true from the very beginning. What is true will always be true. So you cannot be replaced with something else. And certainly cannot be replaced by lies. So what new self could there possibly be? Think about that. What characteristics would a new self have? Is it more true? What about all the truth that's already perfectly true? How can that be replaced or alloyed with something else? Truth can be extended, but that's the very nature of what already is. So it wouldn't be the slightest bit different. How could it be a new self? Truth is extended in some other way than truthfully? How is that possible? It's not possible. So we're opening up the dark doors of unexamined plausibility. That's what satsang does. Behind all these dark doors with locks on them, you see nothing but a plausible, illogical, unreasonable construct that is always fundamentally flawed. But we're told that if we look at this, that somehow we're going to miss out on this new self. That if we examine it, somehow that will stunt its growth and it will abort the whole situation. But how can you abort that which can never be in the first place? A lie denies the infallible, eternal nature of truth without any exception to it. It denies that. So you don't have truth at all. It's a denial, an entire denial of what truth is. You cannot have a partial denial of truth. You can only have a total denial. So if the new self does not embrace truth perfectly, then that's what it's doing, is it's denying truth entirely. And truth is already embraced perfectly by what already is the case. So how could there be a new self? It's impossible. A completely meaningless statement. A new self would have to be one that's entirely based on lies, and lies are impermanent, because lies do not affect truth. So how could it be a new self? The whole notion of a self is that which is eternal and permanent. So all we're accepting, as we follow the idea of a new self, is we're simply accepting the idea of an impermanent self, which itself is impermanent, which is unstable, which is unsatisfactory. We don't like it. And so we're right back, right where we began. Haven't gotten anywhere. And realizing we haven't gotten anywhere, it's very important. It's all important. As long as we believe we're getting somewhere, we will only give partial attention to satsang, to listening, to truth. Because we say, well, I'll give a little attention to it, but I also have to give attention to my progress of getting somewhere towards this new self. As soon as one sees that there's no progress at all taking place, then one is willing to pay more attention to satsang. It works like that. And as we just pointed out, it's impossible that there be any new self. That the idea of a new self has to be that of impermanence, which can't be a self at all, because it has to be impermanent. Which means that there must be something prior to that, which is the true self, will be remembered. So how can there be a new self? It's a meaningless statement. The whole idea of self means that which we are. But since that which we are is permanent, how can in the impermanent be thought of as a self? That's ludicrous. And so we're not making any progress towards a new self at all. So satsang is not interrupting any progress towards a new self. It's merely pointing out that a new self can never arise. Cannot be. And as we glimpse this, then we start saying, aha, satsang is worth our time then. We're not interrupting something else of importance. And that's crucial. And then one can give full attention. When one gives full attention to it, then the whole situation blooms and the panorama is there. Partial attention maintains a sense of strain and conflict. It takes one out of the aha feeling, like, yes, it's exactly so, into, well, it might be partially so, which takes us right back to the notion of a new self, as if a partial self is a new self. Partial self is no self at all. incomplete self is no self at all. And yet we're stuck with trying to accept these notions, these concepts of an incomplete self, a partial self, and then stuck with the notion of trying to complete this self. And we have all these incomplete selves that need to complete themselves, and going through all these exercises of completion, which don't really complete anything, but which we can label as progress. So we're stuck with this whole engine of progress moving toward attempts at completion, and all the conflicts and struggle and drama that brings about, because it doesn't bring about permanence, completion, and therefore the blame arises. It's always frustration, which always tends to go towards blame. The ego says, well, blame someone for it. The ego will refuse to show you the root of the trouble. So the trouble doesn't lie in the impossibility of the goal. The ego says the trouble lies in someone's obstructing attainment of the goal. And then one gets into scapegoating. Blame, anger, attack, guilt, all those things. One feels guilty that they're obstructing progress, obstructing the attainment of this new self, keeping the completion of it from taking place. And so the world is frantically working towards completion. And as you sit in satsang, you're thinking, gee, I might be wasting my time because everyone else is working real hard towards the completion of this self. They're all networking, they're all tweeting, they're all busy sharing themselves with others. And to build up, and in doing that, they're moving towards completing the self, taking incompletion, adding it to incompletion, adding it to more incompletion, and then putting all those pieces of the puzzle together, coming up with an entire picture of a new self. And one thinks, well, I'm just not doing that. I'm not tweeting. I'm not talking. I'm not trying to connect with anyone, etc. I'm just listening to the satsang. And there's that little worry that crops up. That the more one listens, the more one realizes there's no cause for that, no reason for it. It's delusional. And one gets less concerned. Pays more attention. So satsang is a positive spiral. And the more clarity one gets, the less concerned one is about paying attention to more clarity. Realizing that the world is simply engaged in nothing. Waste of time. The world is just wasting its time. Trying to complete a new self is a complete waste of time. Will never take place. And thus, there's only still impermanence, which is a forgetfulness of what we are. And the only remedy remains the same, which is to choose deep remembrance of what we are. One effect. It's a permanent effect, permanent overlay, permanently stable, perfectly, inherently stable. Not trying to change into something else. Not trying to disguise itself. And that this is the real goal, not trying to complete an incomplete self. That's no goal at all. We don't need a soulmate. We don't need to find someone to complete incompletion. We don't need to find anything, any persona. And as we've seen, the idea that there's some I that the persona's arising from is again also false. There isn't any other one to complete. There's simply this dynamic of forgetfulness that keeps churning and keeps shifting and giving us more different looks at deception. But in satsang, one puts it all in perspective, it all becomes very, very clear. It's essential to remain with the simple basics to clarify. That's why questions are not so useful, really. The idea of having people come up and give their question, it can be used as a springboard. Yes, in a sense that there's participation, etc. But it's not necessary either. It's not really necessary. One can simply remain quiet and pay quiet attention to what's going on without having to formulate some sort of question. It's not necessary. Again, who is doing the questioning? The idea of raising a question is assuming that there is some questioner, that the answering of this question is going to help complete the questioner. It's not so. I believe the burden of the idea that one needs to come to satsang and to ask a question is a very strong burden. And people relate to it that way, like, what can I ask? What should I ask? And that puts one in the wrong frame of mind. Forget about asking questions. Don't need to ask any questions. Truth is very simple. It's not needed to ask a question for truth to be talked about. Because whatever concerns one has, the only answer is to put it, frame it in the right context, is that one either chooses deep forgetfulness or deep remembrance. That is the sovereign answer to all questions. And deep remembrance only comes from exchanging the idea of trying to be prime creator for the idea of not trying to be prime creator. So it's better one intuitively can feel that all questions are being answered in this satsang. There's really no need to ask any specific questions. The only situation is to lessen delay to making the choice, choosing a new idea, and abiding in the self, the overlay, and how to minimize the delay. And the way to do that is to point out the impossibility of creating a new self. That it never went anywhere. We've never succeeded at all. We've never even taken one step towards this. So by pointing out the futility, the inherent futility, and seeing it from the position of inherent futility, then no questions arise from that. Feeling that one needs to ask a question doesn't even arise. One can intuitively see, okay, that's the way it is, so that's it. And then when questions begin to arise, instead of trying to address specific questions, one can say, why have I slipped back into forgetfulness? And then address that at its root, which is to say, one is trying to accommodate both truth and lies, believing that there's a new self that can do that. And then re-clarify that this is impossible. So once again, one doesn't need to have to answer any specific questions. One sees that the rising of questions takes place as soon as one tries to accommodate both deep forgetfulness and deep remembrance, and forgets that there's only one choice, one has to choose one or the other. So the only real question is, when do I choose deep remembrance? And that's not so much a question. That is merely a situation of needing to clarify sufficiently and to see there's no exceptions to truth. Any making one exception to truth is a total lie. It's not a partial lie. How can one have a partial lie? Partial lie is a total denial of truth. So by making these statements, questions don't need to arise, really. I don't feel many questions arising for me. Unless forgetfulness comes into the picture, which is, I know, is accommodation, trying to accommodate both truth and lies. And then a reminder of that brings us right back then to this type of satsang. It's like one is either in the water or not. One either has one's foot in the water or not. And once one puts one's foot in the water, one feels the water. Says, okay, I'm back in satsang. Just like that. There's this little bird right now who's hopping all around very close. Maybe it's trying to build a nest, and there's a cat right here. And the cat sees it, but the cat's not interested. Because the cat says, I don't want to bother with that little bird. So, that the cat is like in satsang, saying, the bird is like those who are not in satsang. The bird's busy trying to build a new self, trying to complete incompletion. And the cat says, no, I'm not going to try to deal with that. Don't need to. The cat is aware of the bird, but it's very disinterested. So that's not my cup of tea. Because the cat knows that little bird is very quick. And as soon as the cat tries to go for that little bird, poof, little bird is gone. And the cat would chase after it, the cat would be led astray. The cat's smart enough to know, I don't want to burn out my energy trying to chase after that little quick little bird, forget it. So just like that, we don't want to chase after questions of the ego. All questions really arise from the ego. Spirit is not asking questions of itself. Delay is not a question. It's a situation of fear of loss of continuity. It's a habit. A habit is not a question. It's a familiarity. Familiarity is not a question. So satsang, just spending time and listening, that deals with the problem. The problem is not a question. The problem is one of familiarity and certainty and fear of loss of continuity. Satsang addresses those two, that fear and that habit. I mean, the familiarity, you can put it in the form of a question, like, how do I get free of this familiarity? That's kind of a false way of looking at it, because it's intuitively obvious that one gets free of familiarity with a bad habit by becoming familiar with a good habit. And the answer is to do it. It's completely inherently obvious that familiarity is something you do. It's not a question you answer. So, for instance, this taping provides familiarity for me. By doing this taping and emphasizing this, that is practicing familiarity. That's getting it done. That literally is getting it done. If I just said, how do I get it done? I say, well, I need to tape hundreds of hours of satsang and that'll do it. Is that getting it done? Or is that just providing an answer? It's not getting it done. It's keeping it in the symbolic realm of answers to questions. One doesn't have to answer it that way. One simply does it. Gets it done. That's not an answer to a question. That's an actual remedy to the situation. So familiarity There's no shortcut to it. I mean, one has to do it. There's no symbolic substitute for it. Now, different ones may need different amount of familiarity. Maybe a little familiarity is enough for some. Maybe for others they need more. But at no point is familiarity a theoretical situation. It's a practical situation from its very beginning. So an academic answer to familiarity is useless. It's like one is at the beginning point of a marathon, and one is asking, how do I run a marathon? And someone says, well, you start out and you run and do this. They say, well, how long do I have to run? You know, how many steps do I have to take? And one can ask questions endlessly and never even begin. The real answer is you simply start and you start running. And then you keep going, and gradually you keep going. You keep going and keep going until you finally cross the finish line. That's how you do it. There is no answer. Someone at the beginning of the marathon will say, well, how can I finish this marathon without actually running it, without actually doing it? What's the way to do that? There is no way. If one wants to develop familiarity, which is crucial. Now, one can simply choose a new idea at any point. Even technically, even without any familiarity, one is free to choose a new idea right this moment. But very few will do that without any sense of familiarity, of clarification and understanding of the overlay. Very few are simply going to, without any satsang, any familiarity whatsoever, just wake up one morning and say, okay, I'm going to choose a new idea and experience the overlay instead of existence. I'm going to do that instantly right now and without any familiarity of shifting away from delusion at all. Theoretically it's possible, practically it doesn't happen, other than maybe in a very tiny percentage, almost an infinitesimally small percentage will do that. So it's not even worth considering, because those who will do it don't need any consideration in the first place for it. So we don't need to make any accommodations for them by our considering it, none whatsoever. So we're not hindering them in the slightest bit by going through this period of familiarization, because by very definition they will not need to even consider familiarization at all. What we say or don't say will make no difference to them whatsoever. If they simply spontaneously decide to choose the idea of not being prime creator. So, again, we don't need to even discuss it, because we don't need to make any accommodation for it. It's a non-factor. Therefore, all our discussions are on going through this familiarity, going through this clarification. That is the way. That is the only way, because spontaneously choosing isn't any way at all. It's an immediate, spontaneous choosing, so there is no way there. So we don't need to talk about no way for everyone else. We need to talk about the way. And the way is the only way. When we talk about a way, there's only one way. That is, one moves toward familiarity with the truth and overcomes familiarity with letting go of delay, familiarity with letting go of fear, familiarity with clarification, familiarity with the option, one choice that we have, and familiarity with recognizing that we've been pursuing nothing and we've gotten nowhere, and that all of this is totally impermanent, and impermanence is not truth. All of that, familiarity with all of that, is the way. So by listening to this, you are taking the way. You're on the way. The way is familiarization. Letting a comfort zone develop. And continually moving that comfort zone deeper. so that one can have a comfort zone closer and closer to stark simplicity. It's all black and white. It's either or. Truth or lies. It's the only choice there is. And lies are impermanent. Will always be impermanent. And impermanence will always give way to permanence. Impermanence is just a dream, superimposed dream of forgetfulness that assumes that it's affecting permanence somehow, whereas it's not. We don't have to be in a hurry to finish. Familiarity's job is not finished until one actually chooses the new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, which automatically gives rise to the effect of the overlay, that which overlays all other effects, that which is unaffected by all other effects, gives rise to the effect of unaffectedness. The experience of unaffectedness. Not being displaced. The effect of non-displacement. The effect of non-negation. The felt presence of non-negation. The felt presence of unaffectedness. The felt presence of undisturbedness. The felt presence of perfect peace. Felt presence of seamless gentleness. That overlays, that is unaffected by all other effects. Affectedness that is inherently unaffected by all other effects, all effects. And that does not affect itself either. Unaffectedness. And the world continues in its mad pursuit of trying to complete the incomplete. Lies present themselves as simply incomplete truth, that is, a total lie. Right there, that's a lie. Its presentation of itself as an incomplete truth is a lie. There's no such thing as an incomplete truth. Truth is not incomplete. It's total. But lies continue to present forgetfulness of the self as if truth is incomplete and that we are engaged in an effort to complete it. And that somehow we're on a holy mission, a sacred mission to complete truth, to bring completeness to incompleteness. This is the big lie. The idea that what we are engaged in an effort to complete truth is the big lie. That's the stumbling block. Because we're afraid to stop this effort, thinking that somehow by stopping it we will end up with an incomplete truth, which will mean that we end up with instability, See how clever the whole situation is. You know, by continuing our engagement with instability, somehow we think we're avoiding it. We think that we're experiencing it short term to avoid long term, to avoid permanent instability. But again, how can instability be permanent when truth is only truth is permanent? Instability can never be permanent because it will always give way to truth, to true stability and true permanence. So we're stuck in this clever situation where we think that if we give up trying to complete truth, that we will be stuck with impermanence. And that, so by seeing the total falsity of this statement, that helps a lot. And we have to keep coming back to it, because that's a big one. We believe that by giving up efforts to complete truth, we will be stuck with impermanence and suffering. Fact is, truth is complete from the very beginning. And any notion that it somehow it needs to be completed, that is a lie. And lies are impermanent. So it's the effort to complete truth that is sticking us with impermanence and suffering. And by giving up the effort to complete truth, we're really giving up lies. And when we give up lies, what is left? Truth. And what is truth is permanent. So by giving up the effort to complete the incomplete, we literally then experience that which is already, from the very beginning, complete and permanent. That's how it really works. So you see, you're not a fool by listening, attending satsang, as the world believes you to be. The world believes somehow you're falling behind in completing truth. And now you're seeing that as a completely false setup from the very beginning. That's a very clever, strong disguise that lies are using to simply maintain your state of deep forgetfulness of what you really are, what we really are, which is spirit, which is an idea in the mind of God. And ideas don't leave their source when they're extended. Let's say there's a glass of water and someone asks, what is this? And you say, well, it's water. They say, oh, it's water? Okay. So you call it water? I say, yes, we call it water. And say, okay, I'll call it water. So now we're both calling it water. Has the water been diminished because now two people are calling it water? No. Not diminished at all. Still there. Ideas don't disappear by giving themselves away and extending themselves. Simply, it increases. Reality is based on ideas, which only increase. There's no such thing as a decrease. An actual decrease. Now, if someone forgets that this is being called water, does that actually decrease the water? It does not. Ideas never lose their fundamental nature of they can only expand. That's our fundamental nature. Even if one chooses to forget or drop an idea, that doesn't change the fundamental nature of what an idea is and how it, when it's someone else chooses it, it only expands. Now two have it, you know, where one had it before, now two, now four. And all ideas are in the mind of God. So there's all, the mind of God sustains ideas eternally. And the nature of an idea is only to expand. So all ideas of God are expandable. And they can never contract back to nothing. It's not possible. They never lose their expandability. Again, even if all aspects of spirit drop a particular idea, it's still in the mind of God, still there. God does not reject any idea. All ideas are sustained by the will of God, in the mind of God. And when one picks up again, the idea will automatically then expand, and then more pick it up and expand some more. So eternally, reality is eternally expandable. Contraction, any so-called contraction, is not a real contraction of the nature of an idea. It's a temporary subsidence of actuality of that particular idea, but the inherent nature of the idea, expandability, never leaves it. So there's no reason to worry about any type of forgetfulness, any type of non-attention. It doesn't change what we are one bit. It doesn't change the nature of reality one bit. All ideas are 100% expandable, always will be, 100%. Infinitely and endlessly expandable. And that infinite, endless expandability is already present within the mind of God as perfect, pure functionality and potential. And there you go. That is the reality, that is the truth that we are choosing to have deep remembrance of. That deep forgetfulness of reality, of what we are, has no effect on this. None. Never will. So we're just pursuing nothing. So there's really no pursuit in the first place. So one might say we're simply aimlessly wandering around, milling about. And of course we insist on overlaying this with some sort of plausible objective, like completing the self. This is a very strong delusion. And it bears repeating over and over and over and over, because we'll go right back to it. As soon as the satsang is over, even before it's over, mind we shift back into that pursuit. Because we say, okay, it's about time, it's over, and so now we need to get back to business. Business at hand, which is trying to complete the incomplete. But there should be a sense in us like, whoa, wait a minute. It's a waste of my time. And then we know it's a waste of our time, but we'll do it anyway, because it's our habit. It's what we're familiar with. We say, well, it's either that or choose a new idea, which is true. And so we will continue to not choose a new idea, but continue with our futile wanderings and claiming we're trying to complete the self, the incomplete. Justify our aimless wanderings by trying to ascribe a purpose to it, and we'll use all sorts of big sounding words for it, important sounding words, trying to raise our consciousness, trying to evolve, trying to transcend, trying to ascend, trying to shift, trying to do this, trying to do that. Those are all simply sugarcoating terms to disguise that we're simply wasting our time, aimlessly wandering about, accomplishing nothing. one either has perfect remembrance of what one is, or one is engaged in absolutely nothing. See it that way and save time, save a lot of suffering. One is either engaged in absolutely nothing, or one chooses deep remembrance of what one is, to abide in that deep remembrance. That's the only choice there is. Either abide in deep remembrance, perfect remembrance of what one is, or wander aimlessly about, mumbling incoherently about some sort of meaning and purpose to what one is doing. And again, it's just gibberish. It doesn't matter how lofty the words sound. It's just complete gibberish. One is engaged in nothing. So how can the words have any importance? What is impermanence but a denial of permanence? And the denial itself is impermanent. So what is it? It's really nothing. Simply a futile waste of time, denying permanence, denying what is. Very simple. And so this late afternoon is drawing to a close, very peaceful, very calm. Grateful for the opportunity here to focus on satsang, clarification of truth, and sharing it with wherever anyone may be. And perhaps sometime there may be a even stronger format of satsang, maybe even more lengthy, even more opportunity. And we'll see who sees the opportunity. One who takes it in the right way, which is not to take satsang as some means to complete the incomplete, but as a means to realize that the incomplete can never be completed. It's a complete waste of time. That's the opportunity. That's the real opportunity of satsang. And let's see who are those that can see it that way. Because those are the ones who will abide in peace beyond understanding. And give up the mad pursuit of nothing. And let's do it soon. Let it be soon. Let the clarification and familiarity deepen quickly, and the decision be made. All right. Very great. That's it.